Hello everyone, Phoenix Knight here. Welcome to the channel, and welcome to the winter campaign for Arkham Horror, the card game. We're back to normal, at least on the content schedule front, and it's January. Translation, it's time once again for the winter campaign in Arkham Horror, the card game. Mother Nature has finally remembered the snow that's supposed to accompany the winter, but otherwise we're back to normal. On that note, let's go meet the investigators for this year's winter campaign, and first up, we'll meet the Clover. If you know how I normally play Arkham Horror the card game, you're looking at the investigator I've chosen right now and saying, Phoenix Knight, you're putting a mystic as a Clover? Yes, I am. I actually want to do something different. And to allude to what you're probably thinking as far as mystic as a Clover, normally when I play Arkham Horror the card game and I go through a campaign, if I'm building a mystic, 90% of the time I'm going for a monster puncher with a mystic. But I do want to try out the mystic's clovering tools, just to see what I think of a mystic as a Clover. Generally, mystics tend to be a jack of all trades in this game, and I tend to favor them as Clovers. But we're going to see how a mystic does. And we're going to pick, for to debut on the channel as a Clover, Akachi Onyele, the Shaman. We'll take a look at our Investigator card. 5 lore, 2 investigation, 3 combat, and 3 agility. I'm trying to use primarily her will for her Clovering. She's a sorcerer. Your assets with uses charges enter play with 1 additional charge on them. Her Elder Sign effect, plus 1. Add 1 charge to an asset with uses, charges you control. I will journey to the lands beyond. I do not fear them. 6 health and 8 sanity. I'm probably not using the right mystic for the Clovering, but we're going to give Akachi a try anyway. I also don't want to use a Mystic Seeker splash. I want to try something very different. Let's take a look at the back of Akachi's card. Deck size of 30. Deck building options, mystic cards 0 to 5, neutral 0 to 5, cards with uses charges 0 to 4, occult cards level 0. Deck building requirements that don't count toward deck size. Spirit Seeker, Angered Spirits, 1 random basic weakness. As a young girl in Nigeria, Akachi became used to being set apart. Her habits of chattering away at thin air and secluding herself from other children led her village to believe she was mad. Her village, Dibia, was the first to see her true potential. He believed Akachi was marked by the spirits for greatness, and he taught her how to commune with them to her advantage. Under his tutelage, Akachi grew into a wise young leader, respected not just in her village, but in every community she aided. Now she meets her destiny head-on, seeking out unnatural troubles that only her knowledge can stop. I probably should have mentioned this, but as you probably saw in the box art, we are doing we'll come back to this for a second. So we are doing the Innsmouth Conspiracy for this year's winter campaign. Now, I was talking briefly about doing a chronologically accurate Innsmouth Conspiracy. I'm going to get slightly spoilerific. I would have to get slightly spoilerific to explain why I'm doing chronologically accurate Innsmouth Conspiracy. Say that 5 times fast. But I suspect over the course of the first couple scenarios, we'll probably see why I was thinking about doing a chronologically accurate Innsmouth Conspiracy. But back to Akachi. Her signature card, as we see, is an asset this time. Spirit Seeker, Envoy of the Alusi. 2 cost to play, once it decides to focus. Will, lore, wildcard on question mark. Of course, Akachi deck only. As a fast action, exhaust Spirit Seeker, or Spirit Speaker. Choose an asset you control with uses, charges. Either return that asset to your hand, or move all charges from that asset to your resource pool as resources and discard that asset. So we could theoretically use that to reset something like a clairvoyance or a shriveling, which, yes, I know she's going to be the Clover of the campaign, but she's still going to be able to defend herself. And shriveling's a gimme on that front. But we might need all those charges, because if we anger the spirits, as in her weakness, angered spirits, we're going to have some problems. Revelation, put angered spirits into play in your threat area. As a fast action, exhaust a spell asset. Move one charge from that asset to angered spirits. Forced, when the game ends, if angered spirits has fewer than four charges on it, you suffer one physical trauma. And as we saw, Akachi with eight health and, or six health and eight sanity, that has the potential to get, to roll, start rolling quite quickly, especially if we pull that late in a scenario before we're about to finish everything off. So we do need to be very mindful of that. But that's it for Akachi. Now let's go meet our Monster Puncher. Our Monster Puncher is arguably one of the very best Monster Punchers in the game. That being Nathaniel Cho, the boxer. He's actually one of the starter deck investigators. He's the guardian of that group. Three health, or three lore, three will, two lore, five combat, two agility. Criminal Warden. Reaction, when you deal damage to an enemy by an event or a fight ability on an event, deal one additional damage, limit once per phase. Elder Sign plus one. If the skill test is successful during an attack, return an event from your discard pile to your hand. I must fight on. Nine health, six sanity. Deck size 30, deck building options, guardian cards level 0 to 5, neutral 0 to 5, again, being the guardian of the starter deck investigators. Deck building requirements that, once again, don't count toward deck size. Randall Cho, Tommy Malloy, one random basic weakness. While up-and-coming boxer Nathaniel Cho has offered lots of dough for a title fight, he thought he'd finally hit the big time, but his promoter turned out to be part of the notorious O'Banion gang, and Nathaniel was pressured to fix fights by taking a dive every now and then. His refusal led to his brother Randall's accident. Nathaniel is rightly fed up with the mobsters endangering Arkham's citizens on a nightly basis. Now he puts his fists to better use, patrolling the streets and defending others from harm. But he's about to find out that there are much more dangerous things that lurk in the shadows of Arkham than simple gangsters. Or he'll potentially find the same out about Innsmouth. But let's go through his signature cards. Once again, we've got another asset, this time an ally. Randall Cho, Concerned Brother. Two costs to play. Will, Lore, Wildcard on commit. Nathaniel Cho deck only. As an action, after Randall Cho enters play, either heal 3 damage or search your deck or discard pile for a weapon asset, play it, paying its cost, and shuffle your deck. You gotta give this up, Nathaniel. Sooner or later, you're going to get yourself killed. One health and three sanity. Of course, takes up the ally slot. His signature weakness is an enemy, Tommy Malloy. Two combat, three health, three evade. Prey, Nathaniel Cho only, Hunter. Forced, when Tommy Malloy would take any amount of damage, reduce that damage to one. They call him the Big Palooka. Nathaniel calls him Scum. Two health on attack. Yikes. So he's going to take at least three attacks, depending on if we get any fails in that process. Hopefully we keep that to a minimum, but we can hardly guarantee that because we know the bag likes to be fickle sometimes. Anyway, that's it for Nathaniel. That's both of the investigators taking on this year's winter campaign. So with that, let's move back up top for the tarot reading. If this is your very first time going through an Arkham Horror the Card Game campaign with me on the channel, then you should probably know about the tarot deck. So the tarot deck actually comes with Return to the Circle Undone, which I've talked about the Return Twos before and what they are. Basically, they're like hard. If you think of them as being hard modes from being similar to a hard mode from an MMORPG, like a World of Warcraft or a Star Wars The Old Republic, you'll get the same idea, where the encounters will change, and you'll get some new cards to work with. So think of it as the boss is changing in the dungeon and getting new loot out of it. It's basically the same idea. But as far as the tarot deck itself, it comes with several different cards where there will be a good effect on one side, and then you'll flip it. Then you might flip it for a bad effect. There are several ways you can use the tarot deck. Like you can do a campaign scenario or a campaign reading, where you read for the entire campaign at once. You could do a total chaos reading to take one card in random orientation. What we do on the, what I do on the channel, though, is I do what's known as a balance reading. So we're going to take two cards from this deck. We're going to flip one to the bad side to get one bad effect and keep one on the good side. That way we get one good and one bad effect. So with that, we're also going to give the deck a quick shuffle. And a cut. And those will be our two cards for this first scenario. So our first card for the tarot, for the first part of the tarot reading. The Hermit 9. Increase each investigator's maximum hand size by 3 on the good side, or flip it to the bad to decrease each investigator's maximum hand size by 3. So that would be the number of cards you can have in hand at the end of the upkeep phase. So if we leave it on the good side, that would be 11. The maximum hand size would be 11. If we flip it to the bad side, maximum hand size would be 5. Bad card here, or the other card. Justice 11. Cancel the first doom that would be placed on the final agenda of the game on the good side, or the final agenda of the game enters play with one doom on it. I tend to like cards more, so we're gonna flip Justice 11 to its bad side, and I'm going to make some notes here. So, bad, okay, so good, we're going with the Hermit 9. Plus 3 max hand size. And then bad is Justice 11. Final agenda enters with one doom. And with that, the winter campaign is all set to get started tomorrow. As always, the deck list will be in the description down below. As far as what's coming up on the channel, tomorrow, as I mentioned, the winter campaign is starting with the first scenario, the Pit of Despair. Wednesday, we're venturing back to another familiar universe as we play Aeon's End. Thank you for watching the video. Please give the video a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. Be sure to turn on notifications so you get my content. Be well, stay safe, take care of yourselves and your loved ones, and I'll be back with more videos in the future. Until then, take care, everyone.